Hello everybody again and welcome to episode 5 of From Hereford to Here, which is an independent look at everything to do with Brighton Hove Albion, hosted and introduced by myself, Attila the Stockbroker, John Bain, lifelong Brighton fan, formerly the PA announcer, and one of the many activists very involved in the long battle to save our club in the 1990s and beyond. Each week I have a special guest, and this week it's a great honour to introduce basically the man who effectively saved the club when we were heading for nowhere, who brought us back from the brink. We fans were at the Concord every Monday night calling for someone to come and help us get rid of the people that were destroying the club and take us forward. This man answered the call with great pleasure to introduce Mr. Dick Knight.
Welcome, hi, John.
Dick. What would you like to drink?
I would like a cup of coffee.
Cup of coffee. Well, so, Dick, 21 years since From Hereford to Here. How does it feel? What's your feeling about where we are now?
I think time flies when you're having fun.
Absolutely.
I've got all these lines. I'm much younger than I really look. I mean, I look younger than I actually am. I think the point is that, I think right now, you know, it's just fantastic, but we know where we've come from, and I think it's very important that somewhere that the generations to come do understand that the club, you know, literally came from nowhere.
This is precisely. I mean, I'd just say to the, there's anyone under sort of 20 or under 10 watching this, and there may be a few, this is the bloke who actually started the process which got us to where we are right now. This is Mr. Dick Knight. Have a look at the history. If you haven't seen it already, I know most people will know. Most people, especially with a local programme like this, most people will know where we are.
Well, I think of a certain generation they do. Yeah. But I do think it's important that the younger generation understands that, you know, only, you know, a few years ago, they almost didn't have a club.
Yeah, absolutely.
I was fortunate with the help of people like yourself to lead the club, you know, from a dark place back to the future. I mean, that is where brought the club.
It's back to the future.
And in fact, what I had to do was not only put, you know, a lot of money into it to solve that side of it, but actually to restore the reputation of the club. Because, you know, what those people before us did was damage the reputation of the club in the football business, in the football industry, amongst the, you know, the Football League and the FA. I mean, very few people know, not even the ones who know the history of our club, very few people know that the league called an EGM to throw the Albion out of the league, for bringing the game into disrepute. And when I took over,
yeah, I'd heard about this.
17 clubs voted to throw Brighton and Hove Albion out of the Football League. And look at where we are now.
Yeah.
We're in the Premier League.
Yeah.
And it is quite astonishing because I never forgot those. I was at that meeting. I wasn't allowed to speak because, you know, my predecessor was the chair. But I was there and I saw 17 clubs vote to throw Brighton out of the league.
Was that connected with, I won't name any names, some of our rivals at the bottom of the table?
No, no, that was to do with, you're thinking of...
Of the points.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it wasn't, it was before that. It was before that. It was due to, you know, the goings-on conducted by the previous regime.
Yeah.
The FA and the Football League decided that they would call an EGM to see whether the clubs wanted to just throw the club out of the league.
Yeah.
That had never, ever happened before. The only clubs that were thrown out of the league during the season were clubs for financial reasons.
Yeah, sure.
Ours was not. It was worse. It was actually because it was bringing the game into disrepute.
That's why, of course, we fans got so angry, why we basically declared UDI and we started having these meetings. Because remember, we started the meetings at the Concord in calling for people, for somebody like you to come along. I mean, we wanted to make it clear to everybody watching and listening that the fans of Brighton Hove Albion were totally and utterly opposed to what was going on at the club and we're going to do something about it.
Yeah,
but of course, we could not do that on our own.
What I heard at that EGM was a lot of criticism of the fans, and as I said, I was not able to rebuff that. Only one chairman in the Football League stood up for Brighton, and I never forgot it.
Was it Ipswich?
No, it was the Plymouth Argyle
Right.
Dan McCauley.
Right.
Who, you know, he grew up in Sussex, so he understood what the Goldstone Ground meant and the heritage of the club. He knew some of the history of the club. But all of these other chairmen believed the national press, which was simply talking about hooliganism, which was totally wrong.
Well, of course, I mean, the reason we did the things we did in terms of the pitch invasions and everything was because we needed to bring the plight of the club to the national attention. And, you know, it was a calculated risk, but everybody knew that after the initial tabloid things about hooliganism, the truth would come out. Because once, you know, we're not known as being a club that with fans...
No, but it had to...
But we needed to bring that attention, and we did it, and it succeeded, and it got the national attention.
What had to happen is, you know, when I began to win the battle against Archer, you know, my job was not only to restore the finances of the club, but it was to restore the image of the club within football, and for them to understand, you know, that we were a forward-thinking club, we were going to be a family-oriented club, we were going to be a community-oriented club.
Yeah.
I mean, developing Albion in the community was one of my major passions.
And a wonderful thing it is too. I mean,
Using the power of, you know, football, sport.
Yeah, yeah.
Football in particular, because it is a worldwide sport.
And because it's rooted in the society as a whole, and especially in working class communities, where we can really make a difference, getting ideas, getting help, getting support for people who may be having a bit of a difficult job in life. And that's one of the things that the whole thing was about, obviously.
Yeah. And I mean, and there's actually nothing wrong, John, with actually being rooted not only in the working classes, but as it is now, in different classes.
Well, yeah, well, no, I mean...
But it's interesting, isn't it? Because it's easy to, if you like, criticise the huge amount of money in football. But actually, it is a broader spectrum of people.
I was going to ask you about that. So, yeah. I mean, OK, so football in 1976 or now, which do you prefer?
Oh, now, definitely, for obvious reasons, because 76 was around the start of the real hooligan trouble, publicity.
Yeah.
I mean, I was at a game at West Ham when, you know, in a cup game where the first time a supporter ran on the pitch because West Ham were given a disputed penalty, an Everton supporter ran on the pitch and attacked the referee. This is in the sixth round of the FA Cup.
Right.
And the next day, this chap, who had taken off his shirt, so he was just wearing, you know, he was bare-chested, ran on the pitch and, you know, attacked the ref. This guy's picture was all over the national press on the Sunday papers, which is about the worst thing they could possibly do.
Well, no, but it's the equivalent now of the people that take selfies of themselves where they're... I mean, it's ridiculous. But, I mean, the point about it is, of course, you're right, absolutely, in the sense of the facilities, in terms of the atmosphere, in terms of the friendliness or the kind of safety aspects. Do you think that the atmosphere... I mean, I think absolutely with you on that, on one side, but the atmosphere has gone out of the game.
If you go to
a lot of places in mainland Europe and compare the atmosphere with the banners and the displays and the whole kind of fan culture that exists, say at St. Pauli or at Dortmund or Marseille or, you know, and many, many clubs in Europe, it's on a different level to what we have
here. Yeah, but you say that, but if you saw Liverpool last night against Napoli... Then,
I think Liverpool, to be honest, are one of the exceptions. Yeah, but so, they really are.
Look,
it can happen.
The Amex has been known to be incredibly atmospheric.
Oh, yeah, it can.
You know, when the fans, do you remember when we went down to nine men a few years ago?
Burnley at home.
The fans sang us home.
Man United last season.
So,
and we've got it, and there's quite a lot of people in the North Stand that are really trying to really up the ante in terms of atmosphere. I mean, there's a young fans group, I'm sure you know about it, the North Stand Collective.
Who
want to do this. And who, I mean, eventually it'd be nice to get to the point, I mean, quite apart from safe standing, which would be brilliant, instead of actually standing in the seating area, which is not
very clever.
But it's understandable. But it's absolutely what we, you know, it's what happens, and it's what will continue to happen.
Yeah.
And it should, I mean, you know, at the moment, that's the alternative. I mean, that's the reality of it is that that in our culture, a lot of people want to stand up to watch football, and that's what they're doing, and it is tolerated, which is how it should be. But I'm firmly behind the safe standing program, and it's really only government now holding back. Once the once the calumny against the Liverpool fans at Hillsborough was lifted, once the lies told by the media and the police were exposed, that whole kind of movement, you can't trust football fans to stand up at games, basically started to evaporate, as it should have done.
Well, it's been happening in Germany, for years, hasn't it? In a safe standing environment.
Well, I mean, Dick, I've been known to stand on the terraces of St. Pauli with a pint in one hand, a flare with the pint in that hand, another flare in the other hand, and having the time of my life and not hurting anybody with loads of people doing the
but
same
thing.
But
it's not like it's not like being at the With Dean or the Amex.
No,
I mean, let's face it, the Amex is a great stadium. We fought so hard for it. It had a history.
Sorry to interrupt. I don't like to interrupt our former chairman and vice president, but we'd have a corporate comfort break. This is obviously Dick as an ad man. He knows all about these. Corporate comfort break time.
I'll hand over to you for that.
So, Dick, back to fan culture and modern football.
I hope you had some of my ads on there just now.
No, I mean, that's for me the dichotomy. Obviously, the game as a whole has progressed in a really good way in terms of the facilities. My view about it is that we need to keep, the atmosphere. I wrote a poem about we were playing Aldershot in the Cup. Ages ago,
I remember it. 5-2. And we won 6-2.
And it was the most amazing atmosphere in the ground. I mean, it was just, there was no violence or threats or anything. It was just electric. Mm. And one of the reasons it was electric was because of the old terraces and that feet and the floodlights, the old style floodlights beaming down. It was a different feeling. The Amex is brilliant. I'm not dissing anything about the atmosphere, but it's different. It could be even better.
Well, it will do. It will get better because people, as they get into... I mean, let's face it, there are a lot of new fans at the Amex, you know, with a lot of new Albion fans, and they will get into it, the culture, the feel, the emotion. You know, at the moment, the Albion fans at the Amex, the new ones, have only experienced success.
Yeah.
They're going to face... No doubt in the future, I hope Tony doesn't mind me saying so, we may well have a relegation battle from time to time. We hope that we won't. But, you know, funnily enough, if you experience troubles, that's what binds people together even more.
That's going to be the most interesting time
I mean, I'm sure the club is perfectly capable of really establishing itself in the Premier League. I have no doubt about that. But, you know, it's when you go through bad times or say you're winning 3-0 and you finish up losing 4-3, that's bad times. And it's those sort of fans that stick by a team when they're in that sort of situation.
We did have a bit of that a few years ago when we had Sammy Hoopier in charge. There was a short period, you know, at Falmer. I actually broke my own rule, which was not to use the A word. I always called it, we want Falmer, we got Falmer, it's Falmer. It was a few years ago at Falmer when we had that period. I mean, I remember I held a banner, I had a little thing in the North Stand saying, Hoop replacement needed. Because obviously, you know, it just goes to show you can be a brilliant player, but doesn't mean you're going to be a good manager.
Doesn't prove you're going to be a good coach.
We went through it then, and there was a certain amount of sort of falling off, but it was only temporary. And the moment we were back on track, we're there. And now we're in the Premier League. There's this momentum being built up. And the momentum of loads of people wanting season tickets, loads of people, bluntly, coming back to watch the Albion who'd given up on us in the war years. And obviously masses of young people who previously, during the Gillingham and With Dean years, would have said that they supported Man U or Liverpool or Chelsea or Arsenal or whatever, who now start off supporting Brighton. It's wonderful. Yeah. Southwick Green. I mean, I celebrate this. Southwick Green 10 years ago, 20 years ago, the little kids were running around in Arsenal and Man United tops. Now, on Southwick Green, the little kids, 80% of them running around in Brighton tops. Yeah. That's the difference.
Well, that's because we're in the Premier League. But remember, you know, we dragged ourselves up by the bootstraps when we were at With Dean. And With Dean, you know, does have a very special part, role in the history of the Albion. Because, ironically, you know, I thought we'd be there
genuinely 3 years. Mm. In the end, we were there 12 years, and I was all these lines on my forehead are testament to that.
I remember, I'm pretty much certain that I remember you told me that you said to Mickey Adams, you said, you know, we're only going to be here for, was it Mickey? It was Mickey Adams,
yeah.
Wasn't it?
Yeah,
we'll be here for a year or something.
Yeah,
Mickey,
well, what happened? When Mickey came back the second time, the Sky people, were, you know, all the TV people were there, and they said, how did he manage to persuade you to come back? How did Dick manage to persuade you to come back? He said exactly the same thing that he said 8 years ago. We'll be in our new stadium in 2 years. Yeah. Well, that time, we virtually were.
Yeah, but it didn't work out well for Mickey.
No, it's sad that it didn't work out for Mickey, you know, but he will always have a special place in the heart of Albion fans. Because,
absolutely.
You know, and this
one
time...
One of the great characters.
Well, and the time at Withdean was incredible. We had four promotions at that time. So, you know, let's not ever forget.
When we talk about Withdean and we talk about Falmer, I mean, I'll tell you, my wife, Rabina, who you've met many times, as someone who's originally from Cheshire and a Northwich Victoria supporter originally, who loves the Albion because of me, she absolutely but is basically someone who likes...
I hope she doesn't love the Albion more than she loves you, John.
No. What I was about to say was that she, you know, she came to the Albion at Withdean and really enjoyed it because she grew up watching non-league football. She actually stopped coming to the new stadium because it's too corporate for her and because the Albion isn't her first love. She still follows... But, I mean, I know that's an exception. But for most people, yeah. But Withdean was really special. And, I mean, in its own way, I mean, I loved doing the PA there and it was all completely chaotic.
Well, everyone was sort of very... there was a unity.
A real family.
And a will to win.
Community.
There was a will to win on, you know, obviously on the pitch, but there was one off the pitch. And actually the players, you know, when players came in, I always sat them down and explained exactly what we were fighting for.
Yeah, absolutely.
And so this was much more than, you know, getting 3 points as many times as possible. But it was all about getting the stadium.
It was all about and the unity of the fans behind you or with you and with the board at the time. I mean, the first four guests I've done, you're the fifth. I mean, there was Aidan and Al from Albion Roy, who were both involved. There's obviously Paul Samra, who's one of the pivotal people in the campaign. Yep. Dan Tester, who obviously worked with you for ages on the programme, and Paul Camlin, of course, who started off, you know, campaigning with us on the terraces and is now head of media.
Well, he wrote to me when he was a fanzine writer, saying it was him that wrote to me and said, you know, not long after I took over as chairman, that, you know, I've got some ideas for the programme. So I called him in to say, come in and have a meeting with me. So he was about 19 at the time.
Yeah, absolutely.
And he had some really good ideas about the programme, which, you know, I wanted to revamp everything and bring it into the modern age, you know, as I say, bring it back to the future. So it was set up for the future. And that involved, you know, we were one of the first people to set up a club, to set up a website. You know, we used online, we went online. We had the club website giving information out about the club, and Paul was involved in all of that with me because I come from that background of broadcast and so on.
In fact, there's an interesting point about the online thing and the whole internet thing. We pioneered that in another way too, because at the very beginning of the internet, of course, it was at the time when Richard Vaughan from Plymouth heard about the plight of the club and did that initial initial sort of email post or whatever it was on the very primitive beginnings of the internet, which brought so many people in. And of course, the internet was tiny then and there was just a few people who found out about it, but of course they just told everybody.
Yeah, but what was interesting about that, and it's interesting, you know, is that the publicity around that didn't depend on the internet.
No.
I mean, the ultimate publicity that the event actually generated was, of course, in the national press.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that was probably the first time when that battle really became clear as to what it was actually about. You know, and
one of the things we've said later on is during the later part of the campaign, for instance, when we had the hit in 2005, how much easier it was by that time to spread the word and to organise stuff. When we were doing all the organisation for that and all the other stuff we were doing, by 2005, when we had you know, when the internet was really going and email and websites and everything and discussion boards were really going, not like they are now, but really going, it just made everything so much easier.
Yeah.
In 1997 or before that, when we were fighting for the very existence of the club, it was still very DIY, very sort of old school.
But we were, you know, at the end of the day, I sat Paul down and said, I want to take the club in that direction.
Yeah.
You know, the means of communication are going to be changing rapidly because I was involved in it in my business in terms of media, expansion of media.
Sure.
So I knew that we had to go in that direction, and we were one of the first clubs. I mean, we took advantage of some of the... Paul will remember this. You know, we had some... The Football League came up with some pretty primitive incentive deals, you know, to get clubs to join. Well, we absolutely ran riot through those because we've regularly finished in the top three, and this was including of all the Football League clubs, including the Championship clubs, because we were a bit smarter than most of them.
Sure.
So we generated a totally disproportionate amount of money for the club. I mean, it was still peanut relative. It was thousands of pounds, but not millions of pounds.
Yeah.
All of which went into the battle for getting the new stadium.
Yeah,
and occasionally, me being able to give the manager some money to buy a player, right? And changing to that side of it, because let's do that, I am so pleased that I was able to persuade Glenn Murray to come to the club. Believe it or not, nearly 11 years ago.
Tell that story about the goals, about the 100 goals, you know, because, you know, you tell...
Oh, well, I texted Glenn on his, you know, when he got 100 goals and said, you know, well done. You know, I think I've seen 98 of your goals. And he texted back, well, where were you for the other two? No, but I mean, Glenn has proved that, you know, if you look after yourself, and he's benefited from
absolutely
better training methods, you know, he's looked after himself, diet and all the rest of it. But, you know,
we've got to stop. Sorry, Dick. We've got to stop. We're
£300,000.
Yeah, I know. We're out of time. This will be continued.
To be continued.